Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله أما بعد فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين
آج اللہ تعالیٰ کے فضل سے جماعت احمدیہ برطانیہ کا جلسہ سالانہ
The Jalsa Salana is going to begin UK, and although formally it will start in the afternoon, but as a matter of fact, this the prayer of Juma is a part of Jalsa Salana, and that is actually the opening of it. So with this reference, I would like to say something. Hazrat Masih Maud alayhi salatu wasalam, he has mentioned the fundamental objective of the establishment of this Jalsa is the creation of such community which is always progressing in the realization and understanding about Allah. They should have the fear of Allah, and the piety and nobility should be there, and they should have the quality of God, fear of God. There should be mutual love among them, kind-heartedness, and mutual love and affection, and high standard they should try to achieve. They should be one of those, and they should become a good example of brotherhood, and they should example of Ruhamao Bainahum. They are kind to their brothers. Their modesty, humbleness, that should be their way, and they should establish such high standards of truth which should be matchless and peerless. And those who have keen desire of propagating and conveying the message to the far end of the world. And for this, they should be ready for the offer. All the time, they should be ready to offer the sacrifice of their life, time, property, and time, and everything. So all of us, those who have gathered here today, everyone has to analyze his situation. That after undertaking this difficulties, going through the difficulty of the journey, we have assembled here. And although in this age the facilities of journey are very many, but the temperaments of the people are such that that the discomfort of the journey is felt. They are felt by the people. And although the nature of the difficulty of journey has changed, but journey is journey. So therefore, those people who, for the sake of attending the Jalsa, those who have come, they have to take care of these things, that are we going, do we respect the desires of the promised Messiah, alayhi salatu wasalam? Are we fulfilling the purpose of this Jalsa and the proceeding of the Jalsa? And during these 3 days, when every participant of Jalsa, they would keep all these things in their mind. Only then they would be able to pay attention to this, that the purpose of our participation in Jalsa, what is the purpose of that? And only then such a community will be formed, which was intended to be made by the Promised Messiah, alayhi salatu wasalam. And only then there will be a good change in the temperaments of the people, which will bring about a pious change in the world. If on this direction, if we divert our attentions and our actions, if we don't take our actions in this direction, then the participation in Jalsa will be futile and useless. Hazrat Masih Maud alayhi salatu wasalam has said that this is not a worldly funfair or a gathering, that we come here, we sit there, we sit with friends, and we spend time in good talking with our friends, and then go to the market and eat faluda and pakoda, various edibles, and drink tea or coffee, or the commodities from Pakistan or Indian, we purchase that. Because all these things, they are provided in one place. So let's make a benefit of that. And some people say that all the dry provision for the whole year, we purchase all that and take it back home. Because all these things are good in quality and they are available in a cheap price, and there is not, we don't have to bother much about that. Hazur says, but if this is your purpose, then you have wasted all the good reward of attending the Jalsa. These things on more or less the same price are available in the market. Those people who come here they do not come here to get this worldly benefits and gain, and they should not have come for that purpose. But actually they come here for that spiritual gain, and they should come for that which they cannot buy from any other market. And this is a unique treasure, invaluable treasure. And this is the one, the people who really benefit from that, the people who benefit from that, and such people, they are turned from very poor people to very rich people. And then these treasures, and these treasures have been granted to us by the Promised Messiah, alayhi salatu wasalam, and the distribution of that is done through various programs, and during the various programs it is done, and it will be done. So this these treasures, after attaining those treasures, spiritual treasures, then an Ahmadi should become the means of satiating the desire and satisfying the hunger and thirst of the other people. So this is the duty of every Ahmadi, and this is the duty of every participant of Jalsa, that if there was any deficiency in his thinking or weakness, or if the true nature, the full perception of the Jalsa was not clear to him, so now they have to make their thinking according to the wishes of the Promised Messiah, alayhi salatu wasalam, and they have to get maximum benefit out of Jalsa. At this time, the Promised Messiah, alayhi salatu wasalam, and for the participants of the Jalsa and for the Jamaat, the desire and the wish of the Promised Messiah, alayhi salatu wasalam, which he has mentioned, regarding that I will be saying something. That what sort of Ahmadis Hazrat Masih Maud alayhi salatu wasalam wanted, and what standards of the Jamaat should be there to come up to that wish. And by looking at these statements and the discourses of Hazrat Masih Maud alayhi salatu wasalam, although the full wording will not be his, but I will be summarizing that, these statements which he addressed to the participants of the Jalsa, I am going to present that. He actually gave such a framework and a guideline for action, which is a guarantee for improving and reforming your life in this world and the in the in the hereafter. Inna Allaha ma allazina taqaw allazina hum muhsinun. That Allah Almighty is surely with those people who have the quality of righteousness, and then they are those who perform good deeds. Explaining that, he says that except with the quality of taqwa, Allah Almighty is not pleased with anything else besides taqwa. And when the objective of a believer is this, that he has to please Allah Almighty, so then for this purpose there is no way out for him, that person, that he should follow the path of righteousness. And what is righteousness? And by following which path a person can possibly attain the quality of righteousness? And for an Ahmadi Muslim, why there is a need for following this path of righteousness? Explaining this point, Hazrat Masih Maud alayhi salam says that the community, the Jamaat, the members of the Jamaat, this is essential for them to follow the path of righteousness, because they have a link with such a person, and they are the members of his community whose claim is that he has been appointed by Allah. And the benefit of joining the bath of this appointed one will be only then that that if before joining they were turned towards the worldly gains, and they should get delivered from all types of vices and all type of weaknesses, they should be shunned away. And this cannot be attained unless following the path of righteousness. Hazrat Masih Maud alayhi salatu wasalam, giving one example, he says that if somebody falls ill, whether the sickness is very simple or very dangerous, and if the treatment is not given to that, and sometime the treatment in itself is sometime very painful, but one has to do that, because without that the problem will increase, will aggravate, and one cannot attain health. So he said that if on the face, for example, there is a black spot there, so then everybody gets worried that it should not go on increasing, and it should not blacken my whole face. And sometime it happens, and many people have come to me, and when the spots are there, they are very much worried. Such people have come to me. And similarly, he says that do not minimize the importance of these smaller things, because they take you away from righteousness. And then this smaller vice ends up as a bigger vice. So therefore, be worried and be extremely concerned about that. He says that Allah Almighty, as He is Rahim and most gracious and merciful, similarly He is the one who gives the punishment, and He looks at the community, that the claim of a community is something different. Very high, tall claims they make, but the action, they do not comply with that. So then therefore it is very essential that you reform your practical ways of life, and this is the obligation of each and every Ahmadi. This is a great warning in this statement what he has made. In these days, pray very hard, regularly. This is the occasion of your prayer, time for your prayer, and so that Allah Almighty make you that which He actually wishes us to be. Today, if we look at the condition of the Muslims, so then we should get worried all the more. They are incapable, and their actions are bad. So Allah Almighty should not bring them under their wrath, under His wrath. Hazrat Masih Maud alayhi salam has given the example that when the bad things, vices, and the bad things they start, there is a disparity between saying and statement, statement and works. So then Allah Almighty punishes those believers at the hand of the non-believers. And the history is a proof of that, that many times the Muslims, they were subjugated by the non-believers, like Genghis Khan and Halaku Khan. They destroyed the Muslims, while the Muslims had been promised of divine help and support. He said the reason of that is only this much, that verbally, the tongue declares, the La ilaha illallah, there is none worthy of worship except Allah, but their actions are different, and the actions are completely engrossed in world. So it's it's an occasion of great concern. We have to analyze ourselves all the time, that Allah Almighty, having mercy upon us, guide of this age, and the greatest lover of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, has been sent for the reformation of the whole world. And then he has shown us even greater mercy, that he has enabled us to believe in this the one who has been appointed by Allah Almighty in this age. So if we did not pay attention to Allah, then God forbid, we should not come under the grip of the same course of punishment, which is the grinding mill which moves for those people who have got disparity in their actions and their sayings. So you see that you always try to find out how much fear of Allah you have in your heart, and how far your actions and your sayings, they are in conformity with one another. If they are not compatible, if they are not uniform, then you should get worried. The heart which is impure, whether the words are very beautiful and very pure, but that heart in the sight of Allah Almighty is absolutely worthless. Rather, the wrath of Allah Almighty will be further increase. And these people have come to me, these members of my community, so that they should reform, and this seed should become like a big tree. So therefore, everyone, they should analyze and ponder over their situations, at what is their behavior, and how is his inner condition. And he says that if our community is just like this, that on the tongue something different, and then on the heart something different, so then there will be not a pious end of that person. So he says that Allah Almighty is always watching over you, that a community, that their hearts are hollow, and only from the tongues they make certain claims. So then he is not in need of anything, he does not care for anything. Look at the evidence of history, during the time of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, go to that period and conceive in your idea, visualize the situation of Badr. The prophecy of the victory in that battle was there. Every good hope was there that from every angle they are going to be victorious. But then the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he was praying to Allah Almighty, crying and weeping. Hazrat Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he submitted that when Allah Almighty has given you the promise of the victory in every aspect, so then what is the need of so much crying and wailing? And what is the need of asking and begging from Allah Almighty so vehemently? The reply of the Holy Prophet ﷺ was that Allah Almighty does not in need of anything. Maybe that in this promise there are some hidden conditions. So this is the high status of taqwa, which was the noble, which the example of which was established by the Holy Prophet ﷺ. If with this fear and righteousness, keeping that in mind, if we try to achieve the blessings of Allah Almighty, so then, inshallah ta'ala, God willing, the victory is ours. And are those people, and only those people are going to see the victory. There is a conformity between their sayings and doings. Hazrat Masih Maud alayhi salatu wasalam has described about the Huzur has mentioned about Halaku Khan and Chinggis Khan. He has depicted that situation of the Muslims. If we look around, then we see the same sort of condition. The Muslims have lost their strength, and they are acting upon the plan given to them by others, and they have forgotten the Quranic teachings in their own countries, and in order to save their own power and their own position, they are doing injustice to the people and indiscriminate killing of innocent people is being done, and they think that their thrones will be safeguarded. This is their foolish thinking. The punishment of injustice will be given to them, and they will also be losing their thrones. In those countries where the governments have been toppled, and in the name of people, new governments have been formed, they are also like that. They are also following the policy of injustice and oppression. And as a result, they are weakening their own strength. And while consciously or unconsciously, they are fulfilling the desires of the enemies, that Muslims should become weak and they should stay remain weak, and their resources, the resources of the Muslims, that should be in the hands of the opponents. Allah Almighty is the one who can give wisdom to Muslim Ummah at this time. Anyway, Huzur says that I was mentioning that Hazrat Masih Maud alayhi salatu wasalam, what sort of status he wants to see among his followers, and for which, for that, what statements he has made for this purpose. As it has been mentioned, the real foundation in order to get to this high standard is righteousness. And further explaining this subject, he says that we should always look that in purity and righteousness, how much progress we have made. The standard of that is actually the Holy Quran, that Allah Almighty has mentioned the qualities of righteousness, and Allah Almighty has mentioned one quality, that Allah Almighty always he delivers the that righteous person from the bad things of this world, and he becomes totally responsible for that. وَمَنْ يَتَّقِ اللَّهَ يَجَلْ لَهُ مَخْرَجًا وَيَرْزُقُهُ مِنْ حَيْثُ لَا يَحْتَسِبُ. That a person who fears Allah Almighty, Allah Almighty, at every time of trial and difficulty, he will make the way for his deliverance, and makes the arrangement for his for comfort, which is even beyond his imagination. This is also a good quality of the righteous, that this is also a quality of the muttaqi, that he is never put into the need of those things which are useless. A shopkeeper may be thinking at a certain time that by using a falsehood and without that he cannot do his business, and therefore he does not desist from telling the telling falsehood, and he finds excuses to tell lies. But this excuse is totally wrong. Allah Almighty becomes the protector of Allah Almighty, that righteous person, protector he becomes, and he takes care of those things which are compelling for him. And he says that you remember when somebody has left Allah Almighty, then Allah Almighty leaves him alone. And when Rahman leaves those people alone, then certainly Satan is going to establish a link with that person. So therefore, every Ahmadi, he should always establish his own standard of truthfulness. At every level, he should do so. For example, there are a lot of Ahmadis today. They have come to European countries for seeking asylum. And sometimes, some people, they make misstatements. While the fact is that if they tell the truth, and by telling the condition in Pakistan, then they apply for asylum, even then it is very effective. All those people whom I have advised to tell the truth, and they do not, that I have advised them not to let the lawyers to fabricate their stories, and just tell them what is actually our condition. Even their cases have been successful. In Pakistan, upon the Ahmadis, they are being oppressed, and injustice is being done against them, and there is no doubt about that. And actually, this has gone to the highest level. But the story of this injustice, if it is told in terms of truthfulness, and one does not bring in anything of falsehood, and one depends upon Allah Almighty, completely relies on Allah Almighty, even then the objective is achieved. In this nation, they have got the sentiment of sympathy in them, in the majority of them. As a result of that, they help the people. So on all occasions, we always have to raise our standard of truthfulness. And then advising the Jamaat, the Promised Messiah said that there are two parts of one's good doing. One is which is obligatory, and the other one is which is optional. Regarding those which are obliquely related to Allah Almighty, apart from that, he has given the example of those which are related with the dues towards the fellow beings, there are also obligatory and some optional. And regarding the obligatory things he has mentioned, which are made obligatory upon a human being, for example, to pay back the debt, if somebody has taken the loan, one has to pay it back, or one has to do good in return of good. And this is an obligation upon a Muslim and an Ahmadi Muslim. And he says, apart from these obligations, there are certain optional things added to that one. That is to say that such a good thing which is over and above the obligatory requirements, and if a person does not pay back the debt or does not do the good things, and the optional feature of that is that one should do something more than that, and the prophets, they always do according to that one. And the example of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is in front of us, who was the most highest person. He said that in lieu of the goodness of another person, one should do more favor to that person. And if somebody does a good thing to another person, then the reward of that goodness can only be paid by doing goodness, some good things to that. This is obligatory thing. Allah Almighty has also mentioned that the reward of good thing is only, can be given only by good things. But on this obligation, there is some optional thing that when you do some favor over and above what has been done to you, and if that is done, then Allah Almighty says that that will actually complete the obligation and enables you to get extra reward. And he says, according to one hadith, these are the people, those who actually achieve their status, and they are those people that Allah Almighty becomes their hands and feet. Allah Almighty says that I become their tongue, through which they speak. That is to say that every their action and statement, everything that they do and say, that becomes for the sake of Allah Almighty, entirely for the sake of Allah. And they never ever do anything which is offensive to Allah Almighty or offends Allah Almighty. So this is the standard which Hazrat Masih Maud alayhi salatu wasalam has told us, that after doing our bath, we should go for the standard. And we can do full justice to the bath when we actually do our best and we devote all of our efforts in order to achieve this high target and goal. He said that in order to get this, you have to struggle very hard, mujahida. And only overnight you cannot get that. For this purpose, you have to purify from your selfish egos and desires and selfishness. You have to leave it alone, and you have to follow the path of Allah Almighty. And you will have to work very hard, that none of my doing is not something which is unjust. Everything should be in accordance with the will of Allah. And when this is done, and you will be saved from so many problems in your daily life every day. And he explained that people fall into misfortune and difficulties only at that time when they do something against the will of Allah. Then they do not come under the pleasure of Allah Almighty. Rather, they are overwhelmed by their selfish ego and then do something wrong. For example, they become very angry and then they do something wrong. And as a result of that, some litigation begins. And one has to go to the courts again and again, and one has to go into behind bars. So if somebody makes a determination that without the will of the book of Allah Almighty and without its endorsement, I don't have to do anything at all, I do not have to do any action, perform any action without that, and on everything I have always to look back to the Holy Quran, then the book of Allah Almighty, he says, give the advice of one abstaining from bad things. Otherwise, if people leave the book of Allah Almighty and they follow their selfish egos, then they are always suffering loss. So the bath of the one who has been appointed by Allah Almighty, there is great need that we should analyze ourselves, that do we in everything, if we seek the advice and guidance from the book of Allah, or we get the advice from our own self, inner self. If our own self stops us from acting upon the advice of the Holy Quran, then we should get worried. In these days, particularly during, these are the days of Jalsa, you have to extensively say durood and istighfar, seeking forgiveness of Allah, so that we should be inclined towards self-reformation more and more, and our desires and our wishes, all these things should be made subservient to the wish and desire of Allah Almighty. And also we should pray extensively so that we can really do full justice to the bath of the Promised Messiah alayhi salatu wasalam. Hadrat Masih Maud alayhi salatu wasalam, in order for the community to get to the highest order, it is impossible to cover everything. But one important thing which I would like to mention with reference to the Promised Messiah alayhi salatu wasalam, that is such that if we follow that and act upon that, then in order to get the pleasure of Allah Almighty, always our steps will be moving forward. Hazrat Masih Maud alayhi salatu wasalam says that you get up during the night and pray, Allah Almighty will show you His way. The companions of the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they also got the reformation gradually. Who were they before that? They were just like the sowing of the seed of a farmer. Then the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam irrigated them, and then the seed was right, the soil was nice. With this irrigation, the fruit was wonderful. And they used to walk exactly in the way in which the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam wanted. They did not wait for the night or for the day. So repent wholeheartedly, sincerely in your tahajjud, in night prayer, and leave the weaknesses and vices, and make your actions and your sayings in accordance with the will of Allah Almighty. And the one who is going to follow this advice of mine, and he will pray for that, and practically he will submit his humble supplication to Allah Almighty, then Allah Almighty will show him all the blessings, and there will be a change in his heart. Never be disappointed with Allah. And he says that some people say that do we have to become a wali, a very righteous person? It's very sad that they have not understood the point. As a matter of fact, everybody has to become the friend of Allah Almighty. If he follows the right path, the path of righteousness, he will become the friend of Allah, and then he will meet Allah Almighty. And whether his speed is, his movement is slow, but the speed movement of Allah will be very quick. And the verse of the Holy Quran, وَالَّذِينَ جَاهَدُوا فِينَا لَنَهْدِيَنَّهُمْ سُبُلَنَا, that those people who work hard in our way, we are definitely going to show them the right path. So he says that all these things which I have mentioned today, you remember those things, that these are the in the whole salvation depends on that. Your all the affairs with Allah Almighty should be such that they are all for the sake of Allah Almighty. And this is the way you can become the people on which this applies. وَآخَرِينَ مِنْهُمْ لَمَّا يَلْحَقُوا بِهِمْ. You can really have this quality. So these days of the Jalsa are made available to us. And for the few days earlier on, the month of Ramadan was there, in which we tried to get the pleasure of Allah Almighty. So during the days of Jalsa, ilmi and academic and educational, and in the light of the Quran and the Hadith, the statements you are going to listen, to have the full perception of Allah Almighty, and your intention to have a closer relationship with Allah Almighty will be granted to many. They will be more mindful of that. So with this intention, we should also try to polish our actions. And whatever we have achieved, we have to gather all that and protect that, and we have to increase that. And in every action of us, we have to establish a regularity and continuity. So this Jalsa should also be made a great blessing of Allah Almighty. For getting all these blessing, Allah Almighty enable us to do so. From administrative point of view, I would like to say a few things. Always keep in mind that during the Jalsa, when you come here and when you go back, I mean coming and going, those people who are traveling in cars, so in the parking lots, nor when they come here, some parking is away from Jalsa, so you park the car there and then you come here in coaches, and then through coaches you will go there. So while coming and going, and also when you are doing the parking there, there should be no rush at all. And there should be orderly system, going in line in the queue, orderly, in a systematic way, you should do that. And also while you entering into the Jalsa, where checking is there, scanners are there, you have to go through. So go systematically in rows and in an orderly fashion, you should go through. And wherever you are going to break the lines, there will be disorder, and then it will cause more delay, then more complaints are there. So your time is also wasted. And also it causes a concern for the administration. Similarly, the checking of the luggage, if it is made, then some people complain about that, and they sent the complaint to me. They should actually offer their luggage for checking. This is for your benefit. And as I always say, that I always say at the time of Jalsa, that every participant of Jalsa, while they are sitting in Jalsa, every man and woman, they should keep an eye on their surrounding. This is the greatest system of security, which is in Jamaat Ahmadiyya. If we carefully, we always keep an eye all around. So this, you cannot find this system anywhere else. This is the outstanding feature of Jamaat Ahmadiyya. So never ever become slack or unmindful during the Jalsa. If you look, if you find anything suspicious, always report to the administration. If there is a bag lying somewhere, or some bag is left somewhere, then immediately report to the people on duty. This thing, because the dates of the Jalsa are different, so those people who are staying overnight here in tents or in collective accommodations, sometimes the temperature goes down, they might feel very cold. So therefore, so some people are very delicate, they should put on their warm clothes, and the arrangement of kilts and is there. If they, some people have not brought, they should get one. This is only for a couple of years, and then the Jalsa will come back to its normal days. I have already reminded the workers what are their responsibilities, what are their duties, and they should do full justice to the hospitality, every department, like all the times. They should be very selflessly serve these guests. And regarding cleanliness, regarding toilets, there are certain complaints, if not in a general way. So then there are some people who are very sensitive, those who cannot tolerate even a little bit of filth. So so while the arrangement of the toilets is the responsibility of the administration, at the same time, the people should also do it, that after they use it, they should clean it and then go out. Although there is a separate team has been made for this purpose, and I hope that the arrangement this year would be better than before, but still, the arrangement of cleanliness is there. Remember that the cleanliness is not an ordinary thing. This is a part of faith. The Holy Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam has said so. So a believer, in every respect, one should try to raise and elevate the standard of one's faith. And first and foremost, as Hazrat Masih Maud Alaihi Salatu Wasalam has mentioned, he has drawn the attention of the members of the community that in the prayers and the nawafil, optional prayer and the prayers, they should pay special attention, particularly in these days, they should especially pay attention to this duty and responsibility. The collective arrangement of tahajjud is there. Those who are staying here, they should offer it here, and those who are staying at home, they should also try to offer the tahajjud in their own places. So that Allah Almighty show us the victory of Islam and Ahmadiyyat in an exceptional way. And also remember the Ahmadis in Pakistan particularly, now they are facing the height of injustice and oppression. Only yesterday there was one martyrdom in Pakistan, and one person was fired at, but by the grace of Allah he was saved. And other Ahmadis, wherever they are being oppressed, remember them, and Allah Almighty may show his decree of punishing these oppressors very quickly. And the world should be made of those people who recognize and believe in the Imam of the age. And as I mentioned, there was a martyrdom. So the janaza ghaib of that shaheed, and along with that, there are some other janaza, funeral prayer that will be offered. This martyr about whom I have mentioned, Rao Abdul Ghaffar Sahib, son of Muhammad Tahseen Sahib, who was martyred on yesterday. He was martyred while he was in the school where he was working in Chakiwada. After teaching, he was going back to his home at 5 o'clock, and he just came out and he was just about to board the bus. Then two unknown cyclists, and the people on the motorbike, they fired at him. The two shots were there, one on the shoulder and one on the neck. And as a result of that, he died instantly, and he was died there. Inna lillahi wa inna ilaihi rajiun. At the time of Shahadat, he was 42 years old, and in January 2012, he did the wasiyat. He performed the will. He was paying the contribution for that. He was Zaim Ansarullah and secretary for special tahrikat, very devout Ahmadi. He was very good in conduct. He was very keen in tabligh, and his link of his and his family was very strong. He was very, very good mannered, full of prayer, and attachment with the Khilafat was very deep. And every tahriq, he used to always take part in that, which came from the Khalifa. In 1905, he got married to Kulsoom Sahiba, and he has got two sons and two daughters. In 1988, when they saw the end of the fate of Ziaul Haq and the result of the Mubala, then he did the bath. His mother had already become Ahmadi, and through her, actually the introduction of Ahmadiyyat came into his family. And his sister says that 8 years ago, I saw in a dream that he was shot and he died. But when I went closer to him, then I saw that he was alive. Certainly, Huzur says that this is the status of martyrdom which Allah Almighty had decreed for him, that he has mentioned that the martyrs, they do not die, and never call them as dead. And similarly, a dream was also seen by his daughter and wife, and which relates with his martyrdom. The wife, when she related the dream, then he said that when I get martyred, then you don't have to cry and weep. And his people say that there was a meeting in Ahmadi Hall in Karachi, and he was saying to his fellow people that everybody has to die, but my desire is that I should be martyred. Allah Almighty raised the status of this martyr. His son is a student in Jamia Ahmadiyya, and the other is in matric in 14 years, then 10 years daughter, and then one is 7 years old. And Allah Almighty in his progeny, the dedication with Khilafat should also always continue. The second janaza in absentia, which I'm going to lead today, is that is Mukarma Sahibzadi Qudsiya Begum Sahiba, who was daughter of Nawab Amtul Hafiz Begum Sahiba and Nawab Abdullah Khan Sahib's daughter. In 1927, in June, she was born. And on 1st of September, he passed away in Tahir Heart Institute in Rabwa. Inna lillahi wa inna ilaihi rajiun. She spent the childhood in Qadian in very religious atmosphere, and she grew up there and got the education. After the partition, when he was 20, she came from Qadian to Lahore. And in Qadian, she served the community in Nasrat department for some time. She was the mother of Mirza Ghulam Qadir Shaheed. She writes in one of her article, which I think is very important to mention here. She says that after the martyrdom of Ghulam Qadir Shaheed, that a paper which was very twisted It was quite old, 12, 15 years, and there was a prayer which I tried to convert into the verses, but I am not a poet. So just I have tried to explain my sentiments. Two verses are there, and those verses are that they should be glorified more than ever, and they should be shining on the stars, like the stars, and in the progeny there should be very pious people, and this is my supplication. May Allah accept that. So although they are not very poetical, she says, but whatever I have written, that is actually, these are my feelings and my desire and my wishes, that when my time comes, that we should always be dedicated to you, and we should always be, without your command, no poor person can ever be, his pocket cannot be filled. So please, I pray to you that my children, they should be like stars in heaven, and they should be the pride of land, and this is my humbication, and Allah Almighty may grant my children the life after the sacrifice of Qadr. This prayer was located in my papers. I don't know from which sentiments I offered, but it was accepted. For a moment I got terrified. I have asked from you the sacrifice of life, and from within me the passion of a mother said that you don't ask for any sacrifice from me. Then I started praying that I should be given a long time. I didn't know that the prayer, Allah Almighty has accepted the prayer, and in my youth he's going to get this sacrifice from me, and he's going to take back my son when I'm young. And at the time of the martyrdom of his son, she showed great patience, and I am personally witness to that. She was extremely composed and very steadfast and very full of courage. And when I said, she smilingly mentioned the good qualities of the martyr, his son, and she showed great courage and patience. And she used to continuously write to me, and the last letter which she wrote to me, in that the sentence was also there, this sentence was there, that Allah Almighty may make me and my children grant the quality of righteousness, and we should become the recipient of the prayers of the promised Messiah alayhi salatu wasalam, and we should be actually doing full justice of being from his progeny, and may Allah make it so that her prayer is accepted through his progeny from all members of it, her all family members. As I said, she was the mother of Qadir Shaheed, and she had the desire that the children should be dedicated. Qadir Shaheed dedicated his life. He got the martyrdom. And she was in great love with Qadir Shaheed, and she has decorated the house with his photographs. And when the dead body was lifted from his house, she showed great patience. At that time, instead of crying, she said, Jazakallah Qadir, that thank you, Allah Almighty bless you, Allah Almighty bless you, and thank you very much, Qadir. So this was the desire. Allah Almighty granted her, Allah Almighty have mercy upon him and raise her status. Sahib Zada Mirza Majid Ahmad Sahib, her husband, is also very sick and very old. So Allah Almighty grant him patience and also comfort, and also, as I said, that Allah enable him and his progeny to perform good deeds. Chaudhary Nazir Ahmad Sahib's janaza will also be offered, and he was former Amir of Bahawalpur. Chaudhary Nazir Ahmad Sahib, who was Chaudhary Noor Muhammad Sahib's, he was the son of Chaudhary Noor Muhammad Sahib, who was a resident there. In 1933 was born, and 28th August he passed away. BSc Civil Engineering, he was in Agriculture Department, Irrigation Department, and he got retired from there. And 65 to 67 he was Qaid Khudam Ul Ahmadiyya District Rahim Yar Khan. And then from 83 to 2004 he was Amir of Bahawalpur. He served the community. In 2004, he came to Rabwa, he migrated to Rabwah, and in 74 he had to confront the opposition of the opponents in Bahawalpur. In one of his page of diary he has written that in 1974 there was a great opposition of the whole community in Pakistan. In those days I was in Bahawalpur with my younger brother's petrol pump. I was looking after that because he was sick in those days, and because of the disturbance of 74, the mullahs they had set up the picketing, and they were not allowing anybody to come to the petrol station, and they had put a barrier there. And when Ahmadi came, and so they burnt the motorcycle, and Ahmadi, who came to get the gas from there, and they used to use foul language and abuse the people. So he said that in this respect as well, he was able to undergo this torture and bear all these things. His wife writes that till the last moment he continued to serve the community, because he was appointed Qazi in the Department of Qaza, and the last decision he wrote, and he gave it to me, and he said that nobody should read it and it should be sent to Qaza. And it was quite painful in the last disease, and very difficult to bear. So I told him that it's very difficulty, and write to Huzoor that I can't perform my duties because of sickness. So he said no, he has appointed me and I will continue doing it unless to the last moment as it is possible for me. He was a man of good great qualities. Allah Almighty exalt his station and status and also increase his progeny in good deeds. And the last, the janaza, which the announcement I am going to make is Mukarram Faraz Mahmood Sahib of Syria, in the suburb of Damascus. He got martyrdom because of the disturbance which is going on there. And his dead body could not be located in the beginning. And 30th of August, the body was located and found. And when they wanted to bury, it was stony area, so they couldn't do it. So then the local people there, the other people who died in this disturbance, so he was also buried along with them. So he did the bath 8 years, 8 months ago. And in 8 months, with great loyalty, he established his relationship with Jamaat and did full justice to that. Allah Almighty may exalt his station and have mercy upon him. As I said, the Namaz-e-Janaza, after the Jummah, I will be offering this after the Jummah.
Alhamdulillah, nahmaduhu wa nasta'inuhu wa nastaghfiruhu wa nu'minu bihi wa natawakkalu alayhi wa na'udhu billahi min shururi anfusina wa min sayyiati a'malina. من يهد الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له ونشهد ان لا اله الا الله ونشهد ان محمدا عبده ورسوله عباد الله رحمكم الله إن الله يأمر بالعدل واللسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون. اذكروا الله يذكركم وادعوه يستجب لكم. وَلَذِكْرُ اللَّهِ